My name is Charles Campbell. I've been asked to moderate this oral history program today about the life and career of Senator Herman E. Talmadge. It is August the 9th, 2013. We are gathered at the Richard B. Russell Special Collections Library Building at the University of Georgia in Athens. We have had a luncheon today to celebrate the 100th anniversary of Herman Talmadge's birth with about 125 people in attendance. We have on our panel today six distinguished gentlemen who I will introduce in just a minute. All of them at one time or another worked for Senator Talmadge, either in his personal office in Washington and or on committees that he chaired. I never worked for Senator Talmadge directly, but I met him when I joined Senator Richard Russell's staff in Washington in January of 1966. And I quickly found out that Georgia had not one but two great United States senators. Senator Russell and Senator Talmadge had an extremely close personal and professional relationship, so much so that when Senator Russell authorized the establishment of the Richard B. Russell Foundation, he did so on the condition that Herman Talmadge act as the first chair, which he did for 4 years, and single-handedly raised the money that allows the Russell Foundation to do its work today. After Senator Russell died in 1971, I returned to Georgia and entered law practice, but had an even closer relationship with Senator Talmadge than I had in Washington as a result of serving as his campaign chair in 1974 and 1980. Mike McLeod was born in Dixie, Georgia. He's a graduate of the University of Georgia. In 1967, he joined Senator Talmadge's staff as legislative assistant. In 1971, he joined the staff of the Senate Agriculture Committee as counsel when Senator Talmadge became chair of that committee. From 1974 to 1978, he served as general counsel and staff director of the Senate Agriculture Committee. He entered law practice after leaving government service in 1978, and today is senior partner of the firm McLeod, Watkinson, and Miller. Dan Tate has undergraduate degree from Emory University in 1966 and a law degree from the University of Georgia in 1969. From 1969 to 1976, he was a legislative assistant for Senator Talmadge. From 1977 to 1980, Dan was a deputy assistant to the president and chief legislative representative of President Carter to the U.S. Senate. 1981 to 84, he was vice president of National Broadcasting Company. 1984 to 1992, he was partner in the Washington, D.C. law firm of Camp, Barsh, and Tate. From 1992 to 2001, he was senior vice president of Cassidy and Associates. Since 2001, he has been president of Dan Tate, LLC, a Washington public affairs firm. Rogers Wade served as chief of staff for Senator Talmadge from 1973 to 1980. Thereafter, he was vice president of Watkins Associated Industries, senior partner in the public affairs firm of Eddington, Wade, and Associates. From 1997 to 2009, he was president and CEO of the Georgia Public Policy Foundation and is now chairman of the board of that organization. In 2010, he was asked by Governor-elect Nathan Deal to head his transition team. And in 2013, he was appointed by Governor Deal to the Georgia Board of Regents. Russell King received a business degree in 1971 and a law degree in 1974 from the University of Georgia. He joined Senator Talmadge's staff in 1975 as legislative assistant and counsel. He worked for Southern Railway Company in Atlanta as special representative prior to joining Freeport Minerals Company in Washington in 1980 and serves today as senior vice president of Freeport McMoRan Copper and Gold, an international natural resource company. Randy Nuckolls has undergraduate and law degrees from the University of Georgia. After law school, he joined Senator Talmadge's staff in Washington as legislative assistant and served in that capacity from 1977 to 1981. In 1981, he became chief counsel and legislative director for Senator Sam Nunn and served in that position for 6 years. Randy is currently a partner in the Washington, D.C. office of the law firm of McKenna, Long, and Aldridge. And last but not least, Will Ball. Will served as chief of staff for Senator Talmadge and also in a legislative position, and chief of staff to Senator John Tower of Texas. He served as assistant secretary of state in the Reagan administration. In 1986, he joined the White House staff and served 2 years as assistant to the president for Legislative Affairs and President Reagan's chief liaison to the Congress. In 1988, President Reagan nominated Will as Secretary of the Navy, and he was confirmed by the Senate. At the end of the Reagan administration, he became president of the National Soft Drink Association. He is a graduate of the Georgia Institute of Technology and served 6 years on active duty as a commissioned officer in the U.S. Navy. Thus, we may from time to time refer to him as Commander Ball. Thank you, gentlemen, for participating in this oral history program. This is going to be an informal program. We can talk about anything any of you want to talk about. I will suggest a few topics to provide structure, but anyone can chime in at any time, and we can discuss anything that we want to. We're really covering the Senate years of Herman Talmadge, and that is from 1956 to 1981. But before that, he served 6 years as governor of Georgia, and I don't want us to ignore that period, so I want to provide a little information for the people that might be viewing this oral history program in the future. He was the youngest governor in the United States in 1948 when he was elected governor. But that wasn't the first time he'd served as governor. He served for a little over 30 days as a part of the famous or infamous three-governor controversy. And according to a book Senator Talmadge wrote after his retirement from politics, that came about when a friend of the Talmadge family from Jasper County asked Herman Talmadge if he knew what would happen if his father, who in the 1946 campaign was elected governor of Georgia for an unprecedented fourth time, what would happen if he died before he took office, because Governor Talmadge was not in great health. And Herman Talmadge said no, he hadn't thought about it. But that got him started to thinking about it. And in order to get some protection, an insurance policy, if you will, they decided that they would have some of the Talmadge supporters write in Herman Talmadge's name, just in case his father died. And as the friend from Jasper County explained at that time, the Georgia Constitution said that if a governor-elect died before he was sworn in, the state legislature would select from the two candidates who received the next highest votes who were willing to serve the new governor. Well, Herman Talmadge received a little over 600 votes, and a political gadfly who ran in practically all races received a little over 600 votes. There was a dispute as to which one received the most votes, but there was no dispute that they were the only two that was willing to serve. So the legislature selected Herman Talmadge as governor, and he was sworn in, but the existing governor, Ellis Arnold, refused to vacate the office because he didn't want Herman Talmadge to be governor. In the meantime, the lieutenant governor-elect, M.E. Thompson, and lieutenant governor office was a new office at that time, had just been created, so there was no precedent for all this. M.E. Thompson thought he should be governor, and so litigation ensued. And the long and the short of it is that the Georgia Supreme Court, clearly inconsistent with the Georgia Constitution, a majority of whom were appointed by Ellis Arnold, decided that M.E. Thompson should be the governor, and they ousted Herman Talmadge and install Lieutenant Governor Thompson as the governor. However, they ordered a special election in 1947, the next year. And Herman Talmadge overwhelmingly won that, and that started his 6 years as governor. And those were 6 years of unparalleled progress in Georgia. There really had not ever been anything quite like it before. One of the first things that Governor Talmadge did, which was highly controversial at the time, was to institute the state's first sales tax. And that gave the state for the first time a reliable source of revenue to address all these problems that had been ignored and built up through the years. So he was able to, for example, create the minimum foundation program in education, double teachers' salaries, tremendously intensified school construction. And for the first time, the amount spent on black and white schools was equalized. This was during the time of segregation before the 1954 Supreme Court decision in Brown v. Board of Education. In roads, he revolutionized the way Georgia led its road contracts by instituting competitive bidding and replacing the old system of cronyism. He particularly emphasized farm-to-market roads so that farmers would have better access in taking their crops to the market. He instituted a statewide system of fire protection to protect Georgia's timberlands, which had been terribly neglected. And then finally, He instituted a program of hospital construction, spent over $70 million, which today doesn't sound like much, but at that time it was a tremendous amount. And up until then, when Georgians had to go to the hospital, they might have to go more than 100 miles to find a hospital. So that's just a few of the things that happened during Herman Talmadge's tenure as governor. He was so popular in 1955 when he left the governor's office that less than 2 years later, he was able to force the legendary U.S. Senator from Georgia, Walter George, out of his reelection race because George concluded he had no chance to win. And Talmadge was elected to the U.S. Senate in 1956, served there for 24 years. In 1962, 68, and 74, he had token or no opposition, was overwhelmingly elected until he was defeated in 1980, and we'll talk about that race a little bit later. So now, getting to the Senate years. The first question I want to ask, because Herman Talmadge was popularly perceived as someone who didn't tolerate fools lightly, was somewhat impatient, shall we say, believed in getting right to the bottom line. And so I just wonder, I want to ask the members of the panel, and I'll start with Mike McLeod, since he may not be the oldest, but he's the senior person here. What was it like to work for Herman Talmadge?
Well, you know, it was interesting because he had the reputation of being a very gruff guy, and people were afraid of him. Well, I didn't find that to be the case once you got to know him and did your work. His instruction to young lawyers like me that went to work for him, we had to write a lot of memos, of course, any LA does, was to put it simple, one page in third grade English so I can understand it. And of course, there was a reason to that because lawyers tend to go on too long and have a lot of superfluous words. And he knew, as I have found out over the years, that it's a lot harder to write something concise and to the point in plain English than it is to write in lawyer talk. And the only time I failed to do that, he only had to tell me this once. I brought him in a memo and it kind of rambled around and I didn't really know what I was talking about. And so he said to me, I want you to go out and come back into the office to see me when you've got your story straight. That's the only time he ever had to tell me that, and that made an impression.
Mm-hmm. How about some other people's observations in that what it was like to be around Herman Talmadge and to work for him?
I always knew that Herman Talmadge was as loyal a boss as anyone could ask for. By the same token, he was exceedingly demanding. He expected you to know your assignment, and he expected you to present your case forcefully to him. He loved to have his legislative assistants stand before him and to brief him on legislation that was coming up on the floor. I think it's instructive. If someone talked to the senator and had a complaint about you for the job that you did, the senator would defend you to his dying day. Mm-hmm. But you can believe it privately, he would take you to the woodshed. He was very fair, very demanding, and as Rogers said, he was a wonderful instructor. I remember when I went to work there, I thought I was the smartest guy to walk the earth. I was certain that my mission in life was to remake Herman Talmadge in my image. The first briefing memorandum I prepared for the senator was on amendments to the Fair Labor Standards Act. The bill itself was 2 inches thick, and the committee report was 3 inches thick. And there were hundreds of amendments that had been filed. I prepared my memorandum briefing him, and it was wonderful. I spent 36 hours straight working on it. It was wonderful. I put it on the arm of his desk, and I ran home, took a shower, and came back and was at my post at 7:30, and he buzzed me, and he said, "Dan, come in, please." And I marched into his office, and he said, "Dan, this is a magnificent treatise. Now tell me, what does it say?" And I gave him a pretty good synopsis of what was in the bill. And he said, "You know, you're right. From now on, if you are trying to convey something on paper to a man who's relatively bright and busy, put it on one page, double spaced, and in third grade English, and if you can't do that, you don't know what you're talking about."
Rogers?
Well, I wholly endorse what the lawyers say in that situation. Fortunately, lowly AAs did not have to write all these kind of memos and things. We had to explain why the lawyers were there late and every morning and things like that, but not anything as strenuous as what y'all are describing. But the one thing, one of the things that you said in there about his loyalty, I have never seen him berate any staffer on anything in front of strangers or third parties. Mm-hmm. Like you say, it might get deep when they leave, but he was totally loyal to his people. And that's a trait you don't see that much of anymore.
Russell?
To try to add to some of the things that have been said about how his mind worked and the how much you had to master things to explain them simply, I think that's been fully articulated. But one of the other ways he worked, if you really had a subject that was new to him, he had an ability to bring you in, and if you thought you had mastered the subject, and continue to ask questions till he had plumbed the depths of everything you knew, which meant, because it would be a new subject to him, what a good mind he had to have to be able to check every corner and recess of your mind of what you knew and what something you felt you had mastered. In the years I was with him, I only saw him once with somebody that he couldn't get everything they had, and it frustrated him. But otherwise, it was just an amazing, facile mind.
Rand?
He would always ask questions. I carry on Russell's thought there. He would always ask questions until you couldn't answer. And then he left you walking out of the room feeling you hadn't done enough to prepare because there was that one question you couldn't answer. But he was extremely loyal to you. He never berated anybody in public. And we've all seen senators dress down a staff person in a committee markup or in public in ways that Senator Talmadge just never did. And the fact that he would always stand behind you, if you had made a commitment on behalf of him, on behalf of some amendment that was in a markup, he would stand behind what you had said. And that gave you great credibility with the committee staff, with the other personal staff for other senators, and they knew they could count on what you told them because Senator Talmadge would stand behind you as a staffer, and that was very important.
Well,
one thing I think you have to understand, the Senate back then was a different institution than it is today, and he was one of 12 senators who chaired standing committees, and this is before the Senate reformed itself, undermined the seniority system, and changed a lot of the rules and procedures. So as a committee chairman, he wielded great power and authority, and when he decided something, it stuck. It made it quite different to be in his employ at a time when he was in such a senior position. I think during my tenure, he was the 8th senior senator, chairing the Ag Committee, Agriculture, Nutrition, and Forest. Chairing a subcommittee.
He was vice chairman of the finance committee.
Vice chairman of the finance committee. His most, he derived great power and authority on the finance committee because of his close relationship with Russell Long, and he chaired the health subcommittee of the finance committee, which that position today would oversee the largest single element of the U.S. economy in healthcare. And he occupied a special niche in the defense national security debate because he is a veteran of World War II, and he was one of the group of senators serving then at the time who were combat veterans of the Second World War, his service in the Pacific. So you knew he was a person of great authority, not just a senator from a state, but one who had this mantle of responsibility on him representing his state. And among his colleagues, he enjoyed enormous respect because of his intellect, his work ethic. He was the first or second senator to arrive at his desk every day. And he was known as one who did his homework and expected his staff to do the same.
Now, you mentioned Senator Russell Long of Louisiana, who was known to be extremely close to Senator Talmadge. Who are some of the other senators that were, you would say, were his best friends in the Senate? That just anybody that...
Well, I think prior to all of our times there, it would, or not everybody's, but it would be Senator Russell, because I think he respected and admired him. I think they had formed a very close relationship over those years. And the way he talked about Senator Russell, the way he changed the tone of his voice in talking about him, and God knows we named everything that would fly or float or stand still very long after Senator Russell for several years in there. But it was, he had a close friendship with several senators that were not, you know, headline types. Someone mentioned Milton
Young of North Dakota, yeah.
And Roman Ruska.
And Milton Young was a ranking Republican.
And Roman
right.
Ruska.
And I guess he was chairman during the Eisenhower administration when the Republicans took control of it.
But well, he was chairman during the Reagan years of the Appropriations Committee.
Yes, 80s when the Republicans took over. Right.
Part of the bond, I think, that was there, too, were former governors. I've forgotten what the number was when I got there, but they had a different, even if they didn't like each other, they had a different understanding of what was going on than folks that had come over from the House.
How about Hubert Humphrey? His name was mentioned at our luncheon today. What I know Humphrey was a member of the Ag Committee. What was their relationship?
Senator Talmadge's word for Senator Humphrey was, Hubert is loquacious. Was the word he always heard him say about Senator Humphrey.
But he liked Humphrey, and they used, as I mentioned at lunch, they used each other to advantage. Talmadge used his national standing to have the campaign to create a rural development program, rural development law, and then as I mentioned also, when we were grappling with how to deal with the shutdown in forestry in the National Forest, because of the Monongahela decision, we used Senator Humphrey to get the ball rolling. But they were different sorts, but they had a lot of respect, obviously.
You know, I would say, and this is broader than just answering the question about Senator Talmadge, and this has been brought up in other ways, but the World War II veterans had a bond, and it crossed party aisles. Mm-hmm. And today, a lot of the dysfunction we see in the Senate and the Congress, you can see part of that's missing. That World War II group, the committee I saw the most of with the senator interacting, he was very close with Bob Dole. He was very close with Cliff Hansen of Wyoming. Danny Inouye, another World War II veteran, although he wasn't on the Finance Committee. There was something about that group when the Senate got in trouble on issues or contention and they believed the country was at stake, they would go quietly and informally. That group would get together and figure out how to move forward.
Well, there was a deference among the senators that were chairs to each other's jurisdictions. And the Senate really functioned as a group of committees that brought forth legislation, unlike today, where it's rare to these days to see a real markup in a committee of any consequence. And so we did have to write a lot of memos for Senator Talmadge, but you didn't have to write him a memo very often on a general bill that came out of someone else's committee that he respected. He would rely on that other committee chairman to tell him what was in that bill, unless there was something specific to Georgia that we needed to attend to. But if it was just a national bill of some type that didn't have any specific, unique impact on a Georgia situation, he would rely on his committee chair friend in the Senate to tell him what it was all about.
Mm-hmm. What was his relationship with George McGovern? Now, he was a World War II guy, but had a considerably different political philosophy. What was Senator Talmadge's relationship with McGovern?
Well, they got along, but it was not the friendship and working relationship he had with, for example, Hubert Humphrey, because he felt that Senator McGovern was too extremely liberal. And a good example would be on food stamps and feeding programs. While Talmadge was very much for expanding them and had an integral role in doing that and waiting to the farm bill, he didn't want to go as far as McGovern did. For example, he was a big, Talmadge was a big supporter of the school lunch program and the school breakfast program too, which Senator Russell started with his introduction of the bill that became law in 1946. But we were marking up that bill, I remember once, and what Senator McGovern wanted to do was take it one step forward and make nutrition education an entitlement. You didn't need the appropriations part. And Talmadge just thought that was going too far. And I remember he said to McGovern, "So George, the difference between me and you is you think the government just has all this money to spend. Whereas me, I don't think that the government has a damn dollar until they take it away from some poor SOB in South Dakota. They take it from him and then spend it. They don't have it." that was his summary outlook of the philosophical divide that they had.
Now, Mike, when you gave that answer, you kind of got into the Talmadge voice a little bit, and there's a lot of people that have done impersonations of Senator Talmadge, and that kind of leads me to the next topic I wanted to ask about. He was certainly known as one of the best orators in the Senate. I've heard Senator Russell say, you know, when he rattled off people he thought were great orators, Senator Talmadge, Fritz Hollings, John McClellan, people like that. Now, none of you were his press secretary, but I assume that you were at various times involved with his speeches. When he gave a speech, did he follow a predetermined script that had been written by some staff person, or did he, as we say, wing it, or how did he approach speeches?
Well, when he spoke on the Senate floor, his L.A. was supposed to write him the speech, and we did. I did, and I know you all must have when you followed. He would let you know if it was a good speech. I remember Proxmire was always attacking the defense establishment, and he was attacking our great defense establishment in Marietta,
Lockheed.
So I didn't know anything about these issues much. It was not an area of our great expertise. But I stayed up about all night one night writing a speech for him to defend Lockheed from Proxmire. And he gave a very good speech, I thought. But the only reason I knew it was good as I was in the record, collecting the record after the speech, as we always did, you know, in those days. And Proxmire was, one of these guys, he corrected his own record. So he came over to me and shook my hand and said, "You got me there, you did a good job." And so I knew it was a good speech.
Now, I was told by somebody one time, and I want to find out if any of the members of the panel think this is true or not, that the better a speaker was in the Senate, particularly in debate, that it compromised relations with senators because you'd make a senator look like a fool because you were so much better, you know, in that. Did any of y'all ever see any of that? Do you think that Senator Talmadge could be short with people, as has already been said, including senators? That was not just staff people. Did you ever see any indication that senators held a grudge against him because he had made them look foolish in debate or anything of that kind?
I would say absolutely not. While Senator Talmadge could be curt to his staff. He was unfailingly courteous, to his colleagues. He would never try to show a colleague up in a floor debate, attacking that colleague personally. He would attack that colleague's arguments, and he would eviscerate his arguments, but he was always unfailingly courteous to his colleagues.
You know, on the speaking, I would say, talk about set speech, staff prep speech versus extemporaneous. He didn't always extemporize, but he was always able to because he had a worldview. He had a framework for how he looked at things that allowed him to go in various settings and give a speech. You may think it's extemporaneous, but it wasn't so extemporaneous because he had a frame of reference of how he looked at things. And I'll just do one add, and I think Danny was involved in this, which is just an aside to about speaking. He was invited to go out, I think, to St. Louis or somewhere and give a speech. And I don't know whether it was prepped or extemporaneous.
It was the Jefferson Jackson.
Would you please tell a story?
In the Watergate committee days, Senator Talmadge became quite a folk hero because he was direct and to the point. And the Democrats in Missouri asked him to come and speak to them at their Jefferson Jackson Day dinner. We were scared to death. Because we didn't know how he would be received. He asked Gordon Roberts, his press secretary then, and me to prepare him speeches. Gordon prepared him one speech, I prepared him the other, another speech, totally different. And he went out to Missouri, gave his Jefferson Jackson Day dinner, and he came back to the office on that Monday morning. I went in and said, "How did it go?" He said, "Well, that's just fine." I said, "Which speech did you give, Gordon's or mine?" He said, "Well, I didn't give either one. I threw them both away." He said, "I fed them the same poison I feed them in Georgia, and I think I could be elected governor."
Well, you could see it in his eyes when he had certain segments of Russell's worldview that he had in his framework. He had certain messages that he could put in and deliver as part of a speech. So he'd pull this two-page component part out to talk about the need to balance the budget, or this other component to talk about we're spending too much money on foreign aid, or this about different topics, and kind of pop those in into his speech. And you could just see it in his eyes. He clicked into the next topic that he wanted to put in there very quickly. And yes, he usually had a written two-page, you know, broadly spaced out, high, big type speech notebook, but he would veer off of that most often.
I saw a film recently where he was, I believe it was Face the Nation. It was during the controversy over the civil rights legislation, and he was being interrogated about one of the civil rights bills he was opposing. And it was just a masterful performance. I mean, you know, even somebody that was opposed to his position would have to say that he did as good a job in as few words as articulating the Southern point of view as you could do to a national audience. So I guess his as some of you already said, his agile mind let him in floor debate be a good debater. Mike and I are old debaters over here at Georgia. So that's one of the things, if you can think quickly.
Well, so was he.
And respond.
He was a debater when he was in school.
He was a debater here at UGA, yeah.
Yeah. Now, we've got to move on. And these next few topics are the kind of topics we could take a whole day on each one of them. But I think they're important, and we ought to cover them as quickly as we can. The Agriculture Committee, of course, was his thing. He was chairman of it for 9 years, 10 years, I guess, from 71 to 81.
Yeah.
And he was known, I guess, as one of the preeminent experts on agriculture in the country. And Mike, you worked for him in his office, I assume, on agriculture matters, and then before you went over to the committee staff, and then, of course, you became staff director at one point.
Yeah.
So how much of Talmadge's time did he spend on agriculture? Let's say after he became chair of the committee.
Well, he spent a good deal of time. It was always high up in his priorities, of course, because his base and his people were from rural areas. And rural Georgia was what he cared about so much. And he looked to the future, so hoping that agriculture and the farmers that live there would have a better future. But he was the kind of guy in that respect who could do things quickly. And he would have hearings, and he would let the subcommittee chairman, we had active subcommittees back then, that subcommittees could have hearings. But we marked up the bills very quickly. He had the fastest gavel in the Senate. And it was so different from today when they will quibble over a net, you know. But he would mark up a bill so quickly. I felt sorry for some of the guys sitting at the bottom of the table, because if they didn't get their two bits in quickly, the bill, we'd be past it and done. His favorite expression was, "No objection, so ordered." Bang.
I had Senator Boren, who was a freshman member of the Senate on that committee, I guess at one point, tell me a story. He said one time that Senator Talmadge was marking up in the Ag Committee, and they passed through. He said, "So moved," and they passed something, and Senator Boren kind of screwed up his courage as a freshman member and said, "Mr. Chairman, what did we just decide?" and ask, because that's the way all the committees kind of ran then, although Talmadge was the best at executing as a CEO of a committee and running it.
Yeah.
I've heard it written, I've seen it written, read books, where it is asserted that the reason that civil rights legislation was blocked for so long is that there was a coalition between Southern Democrats and Midwestern Republicans, where the Southern Democrats would go with the Midwestern Republicans on ag issues.
Yeah.
And the Midwestern Republicans would go against cloture on civil rights bills. Did y'all see, do you think that was accurate during the time you were there, or is that, you think that's overdone?
It's probably overdone. I didn't witness it.
In the time that I was on Senator's staff, there were rarely any significant civil rights battles.
Yeah, the last one was 68, I guess, the housing. Mm-hmm.
So by our era, which would be 75 and later, he was voting for extending voting rights. He was voting for Martin Luther King holiday. There was, as some of you know better than I, an outreach. As others know, we hired an African-American professional staffer. So the era we were there, that was all history.
Right. Yeah. Senator Russell said that Herman Talmadge, more than any other one person, was responsible for the effectiveness of the Southern filibuster system, because he came up with the idea based on his experience in the Navy of standing watch.
Uh-huh.
And convinced Senator Russell they ought to divide up into teams, and they'd have a Southern team on the floor and all the rest of them are at home sleeping. And they'd have constant quorum calls so that all the other senators would have to be sleeping in cots out in the hallway so they could be there and meet a quorum call. So he at least Senator Russell thought that Talmadge had come up with an ingenious suggestion. But
as Russell, by the time we were all there, that was all past history, and I never saw any evidence. Yeah. Senator Talmadge was very open to, I mean, we were there during a period when they passed the Martin Luther King holiday bill and other legislation, and he was, you know, he voted in favor of those things. So.
He was the first Southern senator, I believe, that hired a black on his staff.
Right.
Yeah.
And when did he hire Curtis Atkinson? What year was that?
69, was it? 69?
I think Curtis and I came on about the same time. I came in September of 1969.
I think it was about that time.
Came about that same time. Curtis was a very able black man. Mm-hmm. And as you pointed out, Charles, I think he was the first black man ever to serve on the staff of a Southern senator.
Mm-hmm. Didn't he later become Assistant Secretary of State of Georgia?
Yeah, mm-hmm. Max Cleveland. Yeah,
or deputy.
Max
Cleveland. Yeah, but he had a title.
All right. How about the Senate Finance Committee? That was Senator Talmadge's other principal committee. He never got to be chairman of it, but he was vice chairman. And
yeah, he and the chairman, Russell Long, were very close.
How much time did he spend on finance committee?
Oh, he spent a lot of time. And, I wish that I had known more about tax law. I tried to go to school after hours and get a master's in tax. But I had to work so long, such long hours for Talmadge, I gave up on that. You know how that was then. But in any event, he did some things like, his tax credit for job training, which is still in the law in a little different form. But he had to he just had a simple way of viewing things, which is, rather than have all these government programs for job training, which we had a slew of them back then, not quite as many as they have now, but why don't we, instead of that, just give people who have jobs, have businesses, a tax credit for hiring someone off welfare? And we had opposition from the Nixon administration was in then, and we had opposition. But he worked it through the committee and got it enacted, and it's still law. And I still think it's a good idea.
Well, it's more the opposition also was from the left. It was from both sides. That was called the WIN credit.
WIN program.
But the concept of tax credits for hiring somebody to create the jobs and stuff, later, it wasn't Talmadge's idea, but it morphed out of his, which the earned income credit, tax credit. But it's the same concept.
Danny Tate spent the most time doing finance committee work of any of us. And when Russell and I came along after Dan was kind of legendary in the finance committee.
Herman Talmadge told me shortly after I left his staff and went to work on the White House staff, and I believe it was 1980, he told me that he had never lost an issue, a tax issue, that he brought up in the Senate Finance Committee.
Yeah, that's interesting. I didn't
know. Never. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that is unheard of.
Right.
And so that meant that Herman Talmadge was the go-to guy on the Finance Committee. If you got him to sponsor your tax amendment, you were assured of winning.
Yeah.
Of course, you had to make your case for the merits of your proposition before Talmadge, before the Senator would agree to sponsor. He had to agree with you. But he was uncanny in his ability to win issues on the committee. The staff universally loved him. Back in those days,
you mean the committee?
There was no such committee thing staff as a Democratic staff and a Republican staff. It was a
Now most people don't realize how broad the jurisdiction of the Finance Committee, but it not only had tax, but it had trade.
Yeah.
Social Security,
health,
Medicare, Medicaid,
all that.
Welfare.
Yeah, it's
so it was
most
a
powerful committee.
Pension,
it really is.
The pension still is. Federal
and,
one
and
now.
I think, and rightly, we emphasize Herman Talmadge's leadership on all issues involving agriculture, but he had a steel trap mind and.
Yeah, on financial matters.
A facility for complex issues. He could take, and the more complex the issue was, the simpler his explanation. And he would always win.
Dan, you ought to mention something else, too, that you mentioned to us in private conversation about his ability to work with a staff that was not staff he hired. Russell Long hired him. And Tom Vail, who was the finest staff person I ever met, and explain his relationship with you.
Well, Tom Vail was the chief counsel of the Senate Finance Committee, and the Finance Committee staff was exceedingly small. There was Tom Vail and maybe one, perhaps two other people that handled all tax issues. Tom Vail, when Mike McLeod left the senator's personal staff and went to the committee, when Tom realized that I was going to be the Finance Committee legislative assistant, he called me and he said, come to my office at 6:30 tonight. And I was scared to death because he was the vaunted Tom Vail. He said, sit down here. And he said, I'm going to go over with you the issues before the committee so you can brief Senator Talmadge. And every night I want you to come to my office at 6:30 and I'm going to go over it with you until you become facile with the issues before the committee. That was just how much the staff loved Senator Talmadge and how much they respected him.
It was always amazing to watch the health subcommittee staff come in, Jay Constantine and the others that would come in, who he didn't hire.
Yeah.
And those were complicated issues, Medicare and Medicaid, and he would give them the question and sequence of questions like he did the personal staff. And he really would absorb that information in a way that he could then lead the subcommittee in any hearings or markups. He was very impressive.
I can remember Constantine coming in the office one morning when something complicated with Medicaid, I think, was up. And he stuck his head in my office and says, what kind of trap has your senator dug for me today? I said, I don't know. I haven't the slightest idea. I don't even understand the first trap.
And Talmadge was interested in all those things. I remember when I was there, we went on tours of nursing homes in Georgia because, it was a big deal back then.
Charles, there's two issues that Russell and I both dealt with in the last few years of Senator Talmadge's career there in the Finance Committee. Energy issues that now are still in the news, the development of shale oil, for example, production of oil from shale rock was something that Senator Talmadge was a champion of in the Senate and in the 70s. And then bioenergy and renewable energy and biomass. He was supporting amendments back in the late 70s in support of alternative fuels before it was a common and a thing that a lot of people were supporting. He looked forward in a lot of his legislating.
I think I remember that on the shale oil and that stuff, if the price ever got to $18.50, it would be profitable to do shale oil.
What the concept was is Jimmy Carter's energy bill,
right.
and Secretary Schlesinger, the Secretary of Energy, testified before it and before the Finance Committee. Talmadge hears all this and he's hearing about other things, and he learns about what Randy was talking about, unconventional fossil fuel, oil, shale, et cetera, and ultimately things that are, if you will, led to the kinds of things like hydraulic fracking and all that they're talking about, they're doing today. And the testimony was that oil shale had trillions of barrels, but it was $3 above market. Mm-hmm. And so he looked and said, well, that's simple. We'll give you a $3 a barrel tax credit.
All right.
And then if you can do it, you get the credit. And if you can't do it, it doesn't cost anything. So failure cost the government nothing. Only success cost anything, and it basically would have been paid out of it, in essence, by the success.
Let's move on, if we could, to the Watergate hearings. And Senator Talmadge, in public opinion polls that were taken after the Watergate hearings were over, was usually rated the most effective member of the committee. And I guess for the first time in his career in the Senate, he got a tremendous amount of national publicity because of these televised hearings. Now, did anybody here work on Watergate questions? I know the Watergate committee had its own staff. And did they work with Senator Talmadge on the Watergate issues, or did his personal staff get involved in any of it?
His personal staff was rarely involved in Watergate committee issues. In fact, the committee had a budget set aside for each committee member, and that individual committee member could hire his own lawyer to be on the Watergate staff while that lawyer was assigned to the senator. Our lawyer was a young man by the name of Barry Schockett. Mm-hmm. And Barry did a wonderful job for Herman Talmadge. And he did virtually all the work for the senator.
So let's say, for example, Nixon's top aides, John Ehrlichman and H.R. Haldeman, were testifying. Would he come up with questions in advance for Talmadge to ask those witnesses?
Yes, but nobody had to brief Herman Talmadge about the issues, the questions that he ought to be asking. Witnesses.
Because his questions appeared to be very extemporaneous in seeing them on television.
What the public didn't understand, Herman Talmadge was a wonderful lawyer himself. Mm-hmm. And as has been pointed out, he was also a debater. And the combination of that good legal mind and being a debater, he could come up with and frame questions that would be devastating for the witness. He could lead the witness along the primrose path, and all of a sudden, boom, he would hit him with the question that went to the heart of the issue.
Did he enjoy his service on the committee while it was going on? He got a lot of attention, certainly, but did he enjoy it, or?
My view was he did not want to serve on the committee. Then Majority Leader Mike Mansfield insisted that he serve on the committee. Number two, he was not the type of man who enjoyed bringing President down. But as the investigation went along, he became more and more disenchanted with the tactics of President Nixon's close staff, not just his campaign staff, but his White House staff. Mm-hmm.
There's a film about, I don't know how many hours, BBC did it, but it was done out of Atlanta with Ehrlichman in the 90s sometime. And it is a long gathering of all the facts and the things and the testimony and interviews with different people. Ehrlichman did it, and I can't remember the fellow's name that produced it in Atlanta, but it was done while Ehrlichman was living there. He died living there.
You know, he married a lady who still runs a restaurant in Buckhead.
Right.
I see her up there every now and then. And he died, as you said, in Atlanta.
They wanted to interview Talmadge on the camera for that thing, and I remember talking to Senator Talmadge about it, and he said he'd already talked to Ehrlichman. There wasn't anything left to be said about what it was.
Well, it was his comment back to Ehrlichman when Ehrlichman said that the principle of someone's property being sacred, and Talmadge's retort was that hasn't been eroded in this country.
I'm
part of the country. Yeah.
Well, he did end up doing an interview for that film, but he didn't want to talk to Ehrlichman. And Ehrlichman was scared to death of having to sit down. You could just tell it. He was a very sure guy. He wasn't.
Panama Canal treaties. Now that was highly controversial in Georgia, and Talmadge eventually voted for it. And I've read that Senator Nunn, I don't know if this is true or not, but I'd read that Senator Nunn had said that he would not be able to vote for it if Herman Talmadge didn't. He could not.
That was when I was there, and they were the last two undecided votes. They were under tremendous pressure from the president, their home state colleague. They knew he needed their votes, but they were getting floods of mail from the state in opposition, Save Our Canal. And
Dan, you were at the White House then, right?
Well, we got a call from Gordon Giffen about every 30 minutes.
and Senator Nunn was waiting to see what his senior colleague was going to do. Senator Nunn was up for re-election in 78, and his first re-election, and he didn't want to step out in front of Senator Talmadge on something that big.
It's important to understand, talking about Senator Talmadge's position on the canal treaties, that he had in every Congress been supporting a resolution against canal treaties. It was a long history. He was he had taken a public position, and it wasn't just verbal. It was by co-sponsoring.
When you say against canal treaties.
Against any canal treaties. Because the Zonians, the people that lived in the zone, had been lobbying this thing before anybody even had any awareness that it could be an issue. And they'd had these resolutions introduced, and Talmadge had perpetually co-sponsored them. I forget what the numbers were, 70-30 or something like that against them in Georgia. And it's my belief, Talmadge ultimately, as we all know, supported the treaties, but it's my belief the only reason he did is because the president put his presidency on the line for it. Yeah. And we were in a Cold War era, and Talmadge simply was not willing to undercut the president, given that he put the presidency on the line. I think that, my own view is that's what did it. I will say there's one thing that I never saw happen before or since. Typically on the big issues during my era, the senator who would have one or two or three staffers that he tended to look to, he'd go outside and talk to other people, of course, and talk to Sam Nunn or whoever. But on that issue, typically it would have been a Randy, a Rogers, a Russell, maybe somebody else. And he would talk, mm-hmm. and then he'd make his decision. On that issue, he called the entire staff in. Mm-hmm. And by the time he called the staff in, there'd been full 24 media propaganda for the treaties. You had the guy that had written The Path Between the Seas, David McCullough, coming by lobbying for the treaties, and frankly, representing the fact situation of the canal at odds with his own book, which I had read. But when Talmadge called that whole crowd in, and they're like, how many, 50, 20 people? And he polls them. Mm-hmm. And there were two exceptions, but otherwise, of course, the staff's all for the treaties, and he ultimately, but I knew when he did that, he'd made up his mind. He was just looking for a way out of the box.
He went down to Panama, didn't he, didn't he make it?
I don't remember that.
I don't think so.
Okay.
Not then.
But we had every admiral that could walk in there.
Dan, you were at the White House then. Did you, or to your knowledge, did the president directly lobby Talmadge?
I didn't. I don't think there was a single issue on which, one issue, a nomination, that I lobbied the senator on. It was an inconsequential nomination. Both President Carter and Frank Moore, who is his assistant for legislative affairs, congressional liaison, I should say, they did not want me to lobby Herman Talmadge, and I was grateful for that, because I wouldn't have been very good at it. But I know that Frank Moore talked to Senator Talmadge. I'm fairly confident that Jimmy Carter did as well, but more than anything else,
yeah. I mean,
Herman Talmadge was not going to be swayed by the entreaties of the president. Even Herman Talmadge was, I think he voted for the treaty simply because he did not want a president from his state to suffer the defeat, of the Panama Canal Treaty.
On a lighter part of that, now I agree with what you said, but on a lighter part of that, McCullough came by several times, but he brought the book in one time. But I read it. And it was a good book. It had a lot of things in there, and the arguments that he presented were not all in the book.
No, but factual history was not accurate.
But it was a good book. I gave it to the senator one Friday or Thursday or whenever it was he was going back. He came back and he read it, but he had made up his mind. We had already talked about what he was going to do, and he was going to do it. But he wasn't ready to tell. One, he wasn't ready to tell Senator Dunn because Gordon was bugging the hell out of us. We didn't want to tell Gordon.
But Charles, to specifically answer your question, yes, the president invited Senator Talmadge down for a one-on-one to lobby him on the canal treaties. Mm-hmm. And
so served buttermilk, I believe, that lunch.
when he came back, and of course we were all fascinated, the President of the United States sat down with our senator, and so everybody was just around him listening to learn what had happened. And we asked him, well, what happened? What did he say? And he said, well, he says, it was one of them, what you call stroking sessions. And he said, well, what did he want? He said, well, he was trying to get me to vote for the treaties and bring a couple of my friends along with me.
Which he did.
And I said, well, Senator, I didn't say that. Roger said it. Well, Senator, what'd you tell him? And I said, Mr. President, when I think about those treaties, to me, it's like taking a star out of the flag. So that was the response. But even with that, as we learned, history moved him on, and he ended up supporting the president.
During the Carter presidency, which is when I was there, and Russell and Rogers and Will, he always wanted to try to support President Carter when he could. And he would give him kind of the benefit of the doubt, but he didn't always agree with some of Carter's positions. The windfall profits tax legislation, which was going to put taxes on the oil companies in the Finance Committee, and that's after Russell had left, and I was kind of doing the Finance Committee work, and I remember one day, and he had made a pledge to the president, he would support the president on the windfall profits tax bill. Mm-hmm. And one day we were in markup, and Senator Benson from Texas had offered an amendment on stripper wells to provide tax credit for getting the last barrels of oil out of some of these wells that were being depleted. And the amendment was failed in the committee, and it was probably too much of a tax credit, some members thought. So we adjourned for lunch, and Senator Talmadge had a sore throat and went home. He was not feeling well. He went home that afternoon. Senator Benson came back with a modified amendment that was not as generous on the tax credit. And the debate ensued, and Senator Long, of course, was in favor of the amendment. It was not a Democratic versus Republican thing. It was an oil state versus consuming state kind of an amendment. And the vote came down, and it was a tie vote. Well, Talmadge and I think two other senators were not there. In those days, they would allow the staff, if you had a proxy in your pocket, to cast the senator's vote. And so immediately, Senator Dole's staff, who was then the chairman of the committee, starts looking around the room for the staff members of the senators who were absent. And so those guys grab me, and I go in the back room, and I call Senator Talmadge, and I said, I thought if he had seen this debate, he might have actually changed his mind about whether he should support the Benson Amendment or not. And he said on the phone, vote me with the president, which is what I've told you to do, vote me with the president. And so I was back in the back room behind the Finance Committee, and Bob Dole grabbed me by the arm and says, where's Herman? And I said, well, Senator, he's at home, he's not feeling well. He went home with a sore throat. And then David Boren grabbed me and says, where's Senator Talmadge? We need to talk to him. And so I had Boren and Dole both. And finally, Dole came over to me a second time. He says, do you know how to reach Senator Talmadge? And I finally gave him Senator Talmadge's home phone number. I said, now, Senator Dole, if you tell him that I gave you this phone number, he may fire me. I don't know. And so I gave Senator Dole the phone number. He went in the little phone booth there in the back of the Finance Committee room and called Senator Talmadge. And he came out of the phone booth and he says, Herman says for you not to vote. And so I did not cast the proxy in opposition to the amendment, which was the Carter administration's position, and they rounded up the other votes in favor and the amendment passed. Mm-hmm. So,
what year was it that the Panama Canal treaties were confirmed?
78.
Now, that was kind of in the middle of a dark period for Senator Talmadge, too.
And, well, let me just say, yeah. The political historians should note, he did cast that vote in favor of the Panama Canal Treaty, and his Republican opponent 2 years later used it against him in television ads that just were funded by the National Republican Party. They were on TV in Atlanta every 30 minutes, so he paid a political price.
Well, most people considered it was 2% of the vote that voted just simply on canal treaty, for sure.
So that would mean, in essence, that's what beat him. Because
he had other issues, but that alone could have been the difference.
Because the final margin was 1%.
Yeah.
Basically.
It was like 2% that was just hardcore canal vote one way or the other.
Now, this dark period, and in the interest of historical accuracy, I think we have to talk about it a little. We don't have to dwell on it. But in 1975, his oldest son, Bobby, drowned in an accident at Lake
youngest
Lanier.
Youngest.
Youngest son, right, Gene's older. Dan Minshew was his administrative assistant, who was eventually indicted, convicted, and went to federal prison, accused Senator Talmadge of being involved in things that Minshew was obviously involved in, opening secret bank accounts and misusing funds, and which eventually led to Senator Talmadge being reprimanded by the Senate Ethics and the full Senate. He had a very bitter divorce from his first wife, Betty, or his second wife, Betty. He had been married one time before. And then he had alcohol problems that resulted eventually in him going into a treatment program in California. And this is all in a lead-in to the 1980 campaign. Atlanta newspapers fanned all these so-called personal problems extensively every day. What do y'all remember about that period? It must have been a depressing period. Somebody told me that one day Betty Talmadge was in the office and got into a fight with Dan Minshew and proceeded to clean out Minshew's desk and put all of his items out in the hallway. But do any of y'all, you weren't there during, you were there, during Minshew's?
I was there when Dan Minshew came into becoming Senator's Administrative Assistant, Chief of Staff, but I was not there during the so-called dark period you're referring to.
That was before I got there, so that...
After Bobby drowned, and then the Talmadges drifted further and further apart as a married couple. And Betty was not, they just weren't seeing eye to eye, and they were living in a house in Lovejoy in different parts of the house, basically, and not speaking. I think he was not a very happy man personally, but it never affected his legislating that I saw in the first... until the very end, until his alcohol problems got a little bit worse. But I mean, he was functioning because he would go home and probably drink himself to sleep, and then he would get up and run in combat boots at 4 a.m. and be in the office at 7 a.m. And if you could smell his cigar in the hallway, you knew he had beat you there in the Russell Building. And he worked all day, and then he would go home and he didn't eat well.
Let me add to that. The key thing about that period up until the end when it really got out of hand because of the embarrassment to him and what I'm sure he felt, humiliation of the ethics thing, if he was busy and working, he was good.
Yeah.
The demons were on him when he wasn't working. And so the busier he was, the more productive he was, the more able he was, the better he was. It was during recess periods and things like that when he was at risk and the demons had him alone and his isolation as an individual, his staff, which was like family to him, wasn't around him. And that's, in my view, when he was, and Randy said this, but when he was, not just over the evening, it was more the recess periods when
he would binge drink.
And then he would get into drinking and when it really got out of hand, he didn't have an ability to stop.
And when did the alcohol problems get?
Well, as a footnote to that, he had the courage in January 1979 to face his alcoholism, publicly acknowledge it, which everyone who has ever been involved in the treatment of this disease knows that is step one. So he acknowledged it publicly. He went to the treatment, the Long Beach Rehabilitation Center for 6 weeks, and came back and... during the remainder of his life, did not have another drink.
As far as we know.
And he credited, his roommate, a second-class petty officer in the Navy, who came to his funeral with saving his life, because the two of them bonded over licking this disease together and did so.
Let me add, an interesting paradox to this is, as a political matter, before he dealt with his demons, the sharks were in the water politically. He was gone. He probably wouldn't have lived. And the sharks were in the water. when he dealt with it and he went public, obviously he saved his own life, but the politics of it was fascinating. Much to everybody's amazement, it helped him politically. And every family has somebody that's been touched by the disease, and you had people coming out of the woodwork you never would have expected to support him.
I remember the day he came back from the California treatment facility, and we had a cake and things and a big sign for him coming back, and the Atlanta papers were there and covered it all, and it was well publicized in the state. And that's right. I think that really helped.
Oh, it helped. It helped.
And that if he hadn't gone through that alcohol treatment before the Senate Ethics Committee hearings started, he wouldn't have survived any of that.
I don't think he would have.
I want to say two things about that trip out there, though, because I went out there when he had the news conferences and was released and came back home. But I had been out there primarily because Dr. Persh, who later formed the Betty Ford Clinic, said he's different than other people than we've had. And we need somebody there that knows when he's really being straight with us and when he's being an excellent politician. And we laughed about it, but it wasn't terribly funny. It was the roommate that Will mentioned was a young fellow. He couldn't have been more than 23 or 4 max. And the day I got out there, the senator was out jogging, and I could see him from the window where we were out there around this track. So I was sitting there, and I talked to this young fellow who was there, and he was sirring the hell out of me, and all this. Well, about that time, Senator Johnson walks in. He says, "Herman, you're supposed to be on latrine duty today, and look at that gun toilet in there. Say, you spit tobacco in it after." And he just called him everything in the world. And Senator got up right then and said, "You're absolutely right," whatever his name was, and he went in there and started working on it.
Yeah.
And I'm sitting there in total amazement as this young fella, again, served me to death. And I mean, he was not uncivil or anything about it, but they had a relationship there that was of equals.
Charles, the ethics proceedings all were provoked by the bitter divorce between Senator Talmadge and Betty Talmadge, and a fight over some stock that Senator Talmadge had put in Betty's name, and then after the divorce, or during the divorce proceedings, he wanted the stock back because it had been his stock, and so in the divorce, that was a issue that couldn't be resolved and actually went to litigation. And the Supreme Court of Georgia ruled, I think, 4-3, that the stock should be Senator Talmadge's stock rather than Betty's stock, and worth several $100,000, as I recall. So that led, I think, to Betty holding a bigger grudge even than otherwise she might have held. And she kind of tipped off the old Washington Star newspaper. And they sent an investigative reporter down to the divorce proceedings where all the documents had to be put into the court proceedings and were public over this fight. And that led to, I never forget, we were at a softball game, a Talmadge office softball game on a Sunday. And the big story above the fold in the Washington Star was about Senator Talmadge takes $5 and $10 contributions from Georgians. What had happened is Ed Pound, the reporter, had come in and said, "You know, I've poured through your financial records. I don't see where you ever write any personal checks for spending money. Where do you get your spending money?" And he said, "People give me $5 and $10 gifts when I'm out on the campaign trail." And that's what led to the Atlanta papers really looking into a lot of his financial transactions. I've also heard interns and other former staff from old campaigns and what it would be, 74 or 68, talk about being out in South Georgia with Senator Talmadge on the campaign trail, and he'd come in from a big campaign rally and it'd be hot in the summer, and he had a suit on, and he'd come into a room and take his suit coat off, and dollar bills and $5 bills would literally fall out of his coat pockets because the rural people in Georgia would put, that was their way of showing respect. They would give him $5 and $10 bills and put them in his coat pockets.
I observed that during the 1980 race when I'd travel with him in South Georgia. And, I asked him about it because he had given that to me as an explanation when I was trying to decide whether to, you know, be chair of the 80 campaign. Because I'd gotten married, my wife had a miscarriage, we were going to try again. I'd left the law firm, started a new law firm. There were rumors that Talmadge was going to be indicted. So I went to Washington and met with him. And that's one of the explanations he gave me, which I'll have to say I was pretty leery about. But lo and behold, when I traveled with him during that 80 campaign, and he explained that it went back to the time of his father, mm-hmm. that these were older people, that there were no campaign disclosure laws to speak of back then.
No, not
to me. And these people, and somebody would come up, they wouldn't say a word to him. They wouldn't say, hello, Senator, how are you? They just put.
I saw it in 74 as we went all over the very hottest summer I ever remember in South Georgia. Yeah.
Let me. Two things. One is the imagery of that is obviously terrible as a political matter. And the other is the implication that he was spending money. And one of the stories we've all told is of his legendary frugality. So the idea that he was getting tons and tons of money and spending tons and tons of money, that's just not true. He didn't spend anything. He was incredibly frugal. So
he was a miser.
Oh yeah, exactly. So the imagery of the story takes a life that's much, much larger than the reality would have been. I think it was.
Now, let me tell you something I heard, and this doesn't, if true, doesn't reflect too well on Senator Talmadge. I want to see if any of y'all know anything about it, in the interest of completeness. I was told that Betty, his wife, learned that he was divorcing her when they were sitting together in the living room of their home in Lovejoy, and it was announced on the news. Does anybody have any?
That's not right.
Rogers.
Because I was in Florida with him for 3 days at Ben Hill Griffin's place. We were hunting, and we flew back up on a plane and landed at Charlie Brown. I was coming back to Washington, and he was going to go home. And his car was at Charlie Brown, so he drove me over to the airport. And as we pulled into that circle, as you got out to go into the Delta thing, he says, "I'm going to divorce Betty. Talk to Alec." That was a great fear because I knew that if he'd talked to Alec, it was not going to be done quietly. And I got back in the car and we sat there and talked 15 minutes. And it was one of those Talmadge conversations when he was through. Anything else? And,
anything
and that was
else.
It. But that is where they announced it. And I think she was at Sea Island.
I'd always heard she was off in Asia or somewhere for like 3 weeks. He didn't even know where she was during part of that time.
That was when he didn't know where she was for 6 weeks prior to Bobby's drowning.
Okay.
And we spent a frantic night trying to find her at Liz Carpenter's.
Going back to the divorce thing, the way I've always looked at it, and I don't know this, nobody but somebody that lived in their house would know, but I think Randy talked about this. They were strangers that lived under the same roof, I think, for a period of a year or two or more, where they could have been there living under the same roof and had no social interaction.
Judge Newell Edenfield called me one day. He was a U.S. District Court judge in Atlanta, that Senator Talmadge had been the primary mover in getting Lyndon Johnson to appoint to the bench. He had previously been with a law firm I joined when I came back after Russell died, and he said, "I just talked to Senator Talmadge. He's going to divorce his wife, Betty, and he says he wants to hire the meanest divorce lawyer in Georgia, and he's considering Alec McClendon." He said, "In my opinion, he's got more to lose from an acrimonious divorce than Betty does."
That's right.
He calls you and asks your opinion, you could do him a favor by telling him that. Well, Senator Talmadge did call me not too long after that, but he went ahead and hired Alec.
Everyone I know that I have any faith in their testimony says exactly the same thing, and we all told him that on Alec.
Yeah.
So
it suggests, but just like any other couple, it ain't rational when they get into divorce mode.
Yep.
And a man can never win in a situation like that. I've seen it happen too many times where there's that kind of a pissing contest between a wife and a husband who want to get a divorce. You just can't win.
Particularly when Betty is good friends with Ann Cox Chambers, that controls the Atlanta newspaper.
Yeah, it was a no-win deal. But you know, one thing that always bothered me is that story about the money in the overcoat. And I just don't believe it. One thing I did when I was on the Capitol Police Force working in law school, when they would go home for recess, Congress used to recess for several months at the end of the year, you know, then I would live out there in his house in Northwest Washington. And, you know, that's ridiculous, money in overcoats. And when you go in his house down in Lovejoy, when he and Betty were there, their house was open. They didn't even lock it. Anybody could walk in. And the very idea of Herman Talmadge keeping $100 bills in his overcoat was just ridiculous. That was a fabrication.
As a lawyer, I just look at it. They'd already done the property settlement. The money hadn't appeared when they'd done the division. It appeared after the divorce. Right.
There's one other pertinent thing in this, too. There were seven $100 bills, all of older.
6,700.
Right. There were 700 $100 bills. There was $7,000 with Federal Reserve wrappers still on them that came through the Houston Federal Reserve and, according to the Treasury Department, had been distributed to an Austin bank owned by someone in the Johnson family. Betty ran for Congress down there, and the supposition is that money came in there for her congressional campaign as cash from her very good friend in Texas. The other part of that is that money that was in the wrappers hadn't been printed until 2 years after she said that she had gotten it out of the overcoat. And as we have all said, that for Betty to give up money was a serious, serious move because she was
Against this backdrop that the 1980 campaign took place. Which, of course, Talmadge eventually lost his Senate seat in. And the thing I remember the most, and Rogers was involved in this, the thing that was the hardest to do was, and Senator Talmadge had dealt with his drinking problems. You know, he was on the wagon, he was attending AA meetings. When we ran our first polls, it showed that he was in bad shape with the people in Georgia. The majority thought he was dishonest, arrogant, out of touch. But also an even larger majority thought he'd been an effective senator, and he had a lot of ability. So the media people came up with the idea of running what we came to be known as apology ads. Mm-hmm. And Talmadge was totally opposed to it to start with.
Yeah.
But eventually, and Rogers and Russell may have been involved in that as well, I can't remember, but we finally did talk him into running them, and he did, and they were, I thought, pretty effective. Taping them was very difficult.
It was awkward to tape through the
taping was much.
I mean, his heart wasn't in it, clearly. Yeah.
What the analysts said, and they were absolutely right, is people were not prepared to hear any messages, positive messages, until he dealt with the issue. You had to deal with it, and once you dealt with it, then you could run positive ads.
And one of the interesting things about that race, and at our luncheon today, Zell Miller was here. That Zell was the main opponent that attacked Senator Talmadge most vociferously on his personal problems. Norman ran a couple of overcoat TV ads, but Zell was persistent in it, you know, from the beginning.
The overcoat TV ads came back in the general, though, and Mattingly ran them for about 6 weeks prior to the election.
I think Norman first ran those overcoats.
But Mattingly ran them after we had survived the Democratic process over there.
But I remember something funny that happened in the runoff. At least I thought it was funny. We came up with this board that showed how Zell was supporting all these things, and he was a tax and spend liberal, and how much all of his ideas would cost if they were implemented. And Talmadge did very poorly in the first debate in Columbus. And in the second debate,
he's overstaffed.
In the second debate, we were gonna bring out this chart that Talmadge would use at a key point in the debate. Well, he forgot to use it. But I noticed that Zell seemed to be preoccupied. We had it, the chart was there, and there was a cloth over it, so you couldn't see what was behind it. And I noticed that Zell seemed to be really thrown off by it. So we decided in the next one not to use it again. And I think it was either the last one in Savannah or next to the last one we finally used it. But Talmadge was, after that first debate, he was a master in that. I mean, he ate Zell up one side and down the other.
What was the final vote in that primary runoff?
He got 58.5%.
58-42?
Yeah. It was a smashing victory. And then, you know, hindsight's always 20-20. But with the kind of debate performance he showed against Zell, if he'd have debated Mac Mattingly.
Right.
I mean, it wouldn't have, you know.
Right, but we didn't debate didn't want to treat him as credible.
We didn't want to give him publicity.
And anybody that tells you that they said
and the
that
campaign
he
was,
that
was
it,
as you know, out of money and off TV.
Yeah, that was the real issue. In my view, it was the lack of money, and we didn't have polling. If we'd had polling and seen it close, we'd have changed.
There was a bad mistake that made, and I give myself primary responsibility for that.
No.
As chair of the campaign, we quit polling and we quit raising money. We'd raised a lot of money and we'd pressured a lot of people. But when the polls started moving in Mattingly's direction, we didn't pick it up as quickly as we could have. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But I remember having a conversation with the senator after we did run a poll, and Mattingly was, he was still 8 points, eight or 9 points up, as I recall.
We were raising money in the last two or three weeks of the campaign in Washington that we never even got to spend some of it to spend. It was too late.
Yeah.
It was polling.
Yeah, I mean, we didn't have time, but I remember having a conversation with Talmadge because I said, you know, this is now moving strongly in Mattingly's direction, and you're probably going to win, but it's not certain. And I said, you know, one thing we could do, we could go out and borrow.
Right.
You know, a couple hundred thousand dollars.
Wouldn't do it.
And have a vigorous, well, that came right at the time the Republican Senatorial Campaign Committee was putting $200,000 or more in Mattingly's campaign.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So we had a much weaker media buy. But Talmadge said no. He said, there's an old saying, don't ever put money in a campaign you can't afford to lose. And he cited as an example Senator Russell's race for governor in 1930 against Harold Carswell. Carswell borrowed a bunch of money and according to Senator Talmadge was basically a pauper for the rest of his life. So he said, I'm not borrowing any money.
Yeah.
Well, I remember that too, and I got a little different story. But my one contribution to try to help when I was in private practice was to try to help raise money from those guys in Washington that Talmadge had done a lot for all those years. And I was amazingly disappointed in some people. I remember that Russell Long had trouble. I don't know, I think it was the same year. And he went out, and he was concerned, and he went out and borrowed money.
Yeah, but Russell Long had this different resources.
Yeah, but the point was that Talmadge said, no, I'm not going to spend my own money to serve the people of Georgia. If they don't have enough faith in me to return me, then so be it.
That was his attitude. I remember election night, the general election night. I had the flu and didn't go down to the headquarters, but I talked to Talmadge on the phone. And the Atlanta newspapers, as much as they hated him, projected him the winner. Mm-hmm. Two television stations in
Atlanta.
Networks.
He was the first projected winner of that election, and it was two networks and one of the wire services.
I talked to him about 10 o'clock, and he was tracking the returns from about 20 precincts all over the state, that he always used those precincts. And I remember him saying, because people were urging him to go ahead and declare victory, he said, I'm not too sure. He said,
We're
winning,
counties.
But not by nearly the governor
Busby had already come to our campaign headquarters, and
he wanted and to go it didn't turn until 6 a.m. If you remember.
Let me mention a little something extra on debate preparation. What we did was, of course, Zell was running against us, and anybody that helped him, he was for him. And we had, during the campaign, had gotten a questionnaire from the Georgia Educators, Association of Georgia Educators, or whatever it's called. And I read that questionnaire, and it was far to the left. And to have answered it, you had to equivocate. I said, so we didn't answer it. And obviously, Zell answered it, presumably, and he got maximum financial contributions. So when the debate came up, I figured and talked to all of us talked about doing it. And the thing about Talmadge, the unique thing about Talmadge was, because of him and his daddy before him, you couldn't have a meeting in Georgia that there wasn't at least one Talmadge loyalist. And so we went out trying to get a hold of Zell's response to that questionnaire. And I think John Thomas is the one that got a hold of somebody that got a hold of somebody, and we got his response. And he signed off on stuff in that thing. He signed off on health care that was to the left of what Teddy Kennedy was calling for at the time. And then who was our buddy that had worked for the senator on the health subcommittee that then was in the administration that helped us call Jim Monaghan? Who?
Jim Monaghan.
Monaghan. And so that was how we costed some of the stuff. We got all this stuff. And Sal didn't know what it was, but it didn't matter.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right.
And then we went through the papers and the unions, of course, were all with him and not with Talmadge. And, of course, the unions, when they're with you, they say you're with them on everything, including things you don't know anything about. One of the things they said he was for was that the federal government had to approve a plant closure. And during those days, the plant closures were in the north, and they were opening in the south.
Yeah.
So it didn't to be against having the federal government approve a plant closure was against Georgia, and it was transparent to everybody. Mm-hmm. And a friend of mine that y'all all know, Jim Pennell, was watching the TV debate with a friend of his that had supported Talmadge historically, but then was hard over against him. And when Talmadge hit Zell with that plant closure question, this friend, who I don't even know his name, sitting with Jim, pounded the desk, says, "God damn it, I got to vote for Herman again." So a lot of that issue research really did turn votes and help define Zell. Zell did, I didn't blame him for what he did. He took anybody that would help him and made a lot of promises and wasn't seeing.
Yeah, in our luncheon today, Linda Talmadge, Senator Talmadge's wife, when he died, said that Zell called her aside at the state capitol when they were over there for something and said that he wanted to figure out a way to mend things with Senator Talmadge. Did any of y'all have any involvement in the rapprochement to the extent that
Rogers
there was such
did.
A thing?
Well, I would say that probably he did say something to Linda at some point. He had decided largely, I think, in about is when Milner was running against him. Milner came very close to beating him, and not in today's world, but it was the closest thing he'd had. And he and Steve Wrigley both had come to the conclusion that it wasn't any good to be going around fighting things. But Zell stopped me. I think we were in an elevator coming down from lunch at the Commerce Club, not with lunch together, but we were both coming out the elevator at the same time. And he said, I want to get with Senator Talmadge before one of us dies and we leave this undone. I want to bury this hatchet.
This was while he was governor, wasn't it?
Yeah. And I was sitting there thinking to myself, I know exactly where he wants to put that hatchet. But we went on. I went down to see him, and he says, let me back up. We tried to first figure out what would be something that would just be a symbolic move that they were talking to each other again. And that took a while, but we came up with naming the highway down through there. So the first time I mentioned it, Senator Downey says, "I built the damn road. Why should I care?" Well, he did, as a matter of fact. But it was Highway 41 going down through the thing. And after a while, Linda's role in this was convincing the senator that it was important to me because to get along with Zell. And said, Rogers really needs this to get along with Zell. Well, Zell and I were actually by that time getting along pretty well. But that was the genesis of doing this. But when we did it, right up until the day it was done, there wasn't a real sure thing that Senator Talmadge was going to be 100% in favor of doing anything. He was doing the things the way we all saw him do reluctantly okay, I'm going to do this, but.
Wasn't there some kind of a big dinner for Senator Nunn that they both then came to in Atlanta?
Yeah, it was a great picture someplace of
the two of them.
Talmadge, Nunn, and Zell.
And Zell, yeah.
All in tuxes. It wasn't gridiron. But
well, we went down the elevator that night, Charles, knowing that the Senate had flipped to Republicans. As we were leaving Senator Talmadge's campaign headquarters, right, in the elevator with him. Mm-hmm. Or I guess, well, maybe not with him. He was staying there, I think. Mm-hmm. But we all went to bed that night.
See,
we think we've won. Senator Talmadge had won, but the Senate has gone Republican, so he won't be chairman anymore of the Ag Committee. And
Jesse
then
Helms,
at 5 in
Jesse
the morning.
Helms had already called him and said, yeah, Herman, I don't know what we're going to do, but I'm glad you're going to be there.
Right. And then the radio clicked on the alarm in the hotel room I was sharing with another staffer, Bobby Avery. We were sharing a room, and the first thing we heard was Mac Mattingly has gone ahead because of the late votes that came in from Cobb and County. And the Muskogee, was it Columbus too? There were some votes voting.
Yeah, but the, one of the fascinating things was that the senator would never, people were pressing him, and I'm
he
not talking
never,
about you guys, declare. Outsiders, if you were constantly asking him to declare, because he had been declared by the networks and all of that,
right,
to declare, and he wouldn't do it, which I found fascinating.
Right. Governor Busby was the one that was pushing the hardest because he wanted to go home.
Yeah. Right. I'll tell you something, I remember the next morning, after I guess Mattingly had about his 1% lead, and people were urging Talmadge to seek a recount.
Yep.
And I remember talking to him on the phone.
Yep.
And he said, no, I don't think so. I think we've... I got the impression, I may be totally wrong, he was almost relieved that maybe he wasn't going back up there. Do you think there's anything to that, or do you think he... When I talked to him in the period right after that, he didn't seem to be crushed. I would have been if I'd have just got defeated after 24 years in the Senate, but I don't know. Y'all knew him better than I did.
I don't know whether he achieved that relieved feeling right away, because he immediately went into the mask of putting the thing.
Well, and he didn't.
But he didn't go back to drinking.
He didn't come back to Washington. The Congress was still in session there. We had a lame duck session that year.
Yeah.
And he didn't come back. And we had a big piece of legislation in the Finance Committee in conference. And I'll never forget being sitting behind Chairman Long and Chairman Packwood, I guess, Bob Packwood on the House side. Mm-hmm. And there were several Talmadge amendments. These were on bioenergy. I can't remember the guy's name that had been asking us to do those. But anyway, the Joint Tax Committee, Jim, what was his name, Russell, Jim... anyway, the way he had drafted the conference document,
Wexler?
Jim, Wexler. The way he had drafted the conference documents to be presented to the conference to vote on, it basically gutted the Talmadge amendments. And I'm sitting there, and Senator Talmadge is down in Georgia. He didn't come back, and I had to go to Senator Long's equivalent of mine, the L.A. for Senator Long. I said, get Senator Long to ask these questions about the way they've drafted this language, because it undermines Senator Talmadge's amendments. And Senator Long asked the questions, and we were able to salvage one of the amendments. But he didn't come. Senator Talmadge just didn't want to come back to Washington after he was defeated.
Yeah, I don't think he was relieved, but he did, you know, in his in the way he did business, Mike, you know, he moved on. Decisions were made, on. I think he instantly moved on. Rogers and I were at the House at 6:15 that morning, and Barry Goldwater called him, and I remember him telling Goldwater, because Goldwater's race was right on the fence, if you recall, and the networks had said Goldwater had lost, so they were flipped. Mm-hmm.
Well,
he's a Republican.
1980 was a disaster for the Democrats.
But he said...
Even though Carter carried Georgia...
Correct.
He didn't carry... The Republicans took control of the Senate and swept out Warren Magnuson and...
Right.
George McGovern and
Frank
Church,
Gaylord Nelson, all the Southern, a lot of the Democratic chairmen lost.
Bob Morgan and Childs had gotten beat in a primary, and then who got beat in Alabama? Donald Stewart.
It was a bunch of chairmen. Gaylord Nelson and Frank Church and George McGovern and Magnus.
That was six. But President Reagan, I remember looking at those polls. And you mentioned Cobb County just because President Reagan carried, I know
Cobb County by a significant margin, though President Carter carried his home state, obviously. But that vote went for Mattingly in Cobb County, not 2-1, but 3-1. Well, and those were a lot of people at the time, you know, moving into Georgia.
Yep. Looking back on it in hindsight, the trend was starting that has now resulted in the Democrats not having a single statewide elected office in Georgia.
Right. Right.
If you take Fayette County, for example, which was the home of Buck Murphy and the Red Wines that were such strong Talmadge people, Mattingly carried Fayette County.
Yeah.
Substantially, it wasn't even real close.
Well, and you look at the Russell statistic of 2% of the voters that made their vote against Senator Talmadge because of the Panama Canal treaties. And I can't tell you, I went immediately over. Fortunately for me, I went over, and Senator Nunn hired me to be his legislative director. But I can't tell you over the next 2 or 3 years how many people I bumped into around the state of Georgia in my role with Senator Nunn who said, "I didn't really want Herman to lose. I just wanted to send him a message, and I didn't think it was going to be that close, so I've cast my vote against him just to kind of send him a message to make it close." But they didn't really want him to lose, and we're surprised.
Well, remember the term was Reagan Democrats. Yeah. That was the term, and things like the canal treaties and some of these other issues, got Reagan Democrats, which was the Carter vote and the Talmadge vote. In Georgia wasn't congruent, obviously. And Carter was a little over here, and Talmadge was over here. And that Reagan thing cut into what was the Talmadge majority. Obviously, took it away from him.
You wouldn't today. I was just to close out the Barry Goldwater anecdote. He called Senator Talmadge that morning, and the senator said, "Well, Barry, I got myself beat." He spoke that in the vernacular. And but he told Barry Goldwater, "But I sure am glad to see you made it." And you think about today how much the Senate has changed. Mm-hmm. And I was senior Republican, senior Democrat.
Yeah. Well, that's true, Rogers.
You'd never see that today.
That's true. Well, question came up earlier, who his close friends were in the Senate.
Yeah.
Talmadge's close friends. And Barry Goldwater was one of them. They were very good friends.
Right.
I noticed it whenever they were on the floor together.
I looked at a statistic, Charles, that's kind of interesting. The top 20 senators in seniority in the history of the Senate, Senator Talmadge served with 19 of the 20. The period after World War II, and all those World War II veterans or people that were elected in the 40s, they were all there and served long periods of time. And he served with all of these people that were the longest-serving senators in the history of the Senate. And his span would go from Carl Hayden, who was first elected in the 20s, to now there are 5 senators still in the Senate that he served with. And some Pat Leahy's the pro tem. Those guys may go on. Well, two of them, Levin and Baucus, are retiring. But the others might stay on another 4 or 6 years. He will have had a range of 90 plus years of senators that he served with in terms of the coverage of the history of the Senate. Mm-hmm.
Somebody said at the luncheon today that Herman Talmadge was kind of the quintessential executive in charge, and which is kind of different from being a legislator. Do you think did he, aside from this period of personal problems and all that, did he genuinely enjoy being a senator?
I think he enjoyed being a governor a heck of a lot more. And we've all said the same.
He enjoyed being chairman. And he was good at it, and I think he knew he was good at it.
Yeah, he knew.
Asking the question the way you did gives me a chance to relate that to something else, another point I want, because I think they're related. And that has to do with how he worked with staff.
Right.
He empowered staff. We all know that, those of us that work for him. And he developed trust, and they with him, and loyalty, and the staff had almost total authority once he decided that they would do what he would likely do if he were there. And so, in a sense, by that, he empowered himself where he, in that executive role you're talking about, where he empowered the staff. So people, you say, did he spend a lot of time at the Finance Committee? During my era, the answer is no. But unless you count me being there for him. And I was there carrying his water, doing what he either directed me to do or what I was almost certain that he would do were he there. And through that, I think he leveraged who he was and his power.
And then he would
come
into a markup like a CEO might come into a board meeting and execute.
Exactly.
Or if he got a phone call and got a constituent on the phone about a topic, and then the red light would go on, the old hold button on the old-timey phones, if that light kicked on, that you knew that was a senator on the phone, and then your phone rang, that meant he was calling you, and he'd say, Randy, this is Joe from Unadilla. Joe, this is Randy. Randy, this is Joe's problem, and now take care of it. And then he'd get off the line.
That's right.
And leave you dealing with the constituent on whatever the issue was. So he passed the problem on to you to carry out the what needed to be done.
Yeah,
but Joe got through
Russell
on the phone.
Russell put his finger kind of on
Joe got through.
Why he was good to work for. He was not a nitpicker down in the details, which some senators are, believe it or not. It's surprisingly numbered. But once you earned his trust and he knew you were doing what he wanted to do, he didn't bother himself with a lot of these details, and he depended on you to do it. And as a result, you, as a very young staff person, I think, in our cases, we had a tremendous amount of leeway, frightening. When I think back on it, that a young kid like that would have that much leeway.
But it was leeway to do what we thought he would want.
Yeah. That's true.
And we all seen Hill staffers that are off on their own.
They could abuse it.
I don't like that.
Everybody's going to have an opportunity to give one last anecdote. I'm just going to go around the entire panel. But before we do that, I want to ask a question we hadn't really talked about much. And that is, in answering constituent mail, I remember in Senator Russell's office, you had to use the language that Senator Russell had used in letters he had dictated. And if you, got carried away with yourself and you branched out and you were kind of using your own language, a lot of times a letter would come back from Senator Russell saying, I like my language better. Did Senator Talmadge have anything like that, or did you have the freedom to... Now, did you have a dictation file and you got to use...
We just dictated them. I didn't have any...
We knew what the direction was in there. Russell's the only one that deviated.
And banker in the world.
we had standard paragraphs. In the era that we were there, it was before computer. I mean, you had big mass mailings that people were writing hundreds of letters.
You had the Quicks machine.
Robo letters, we call them, where it was a form letter that we sent back and was signed. He probably would have we knew what he would have seen the draft of that, at least cursorily had seen the draft.
But he didn't nitpick language.
No, he didn't
like,
nitpick.
This is not exactly what I wanted.
We knew how to mimic his words in some of the topic areas.
If it was a seminal issue, it was pretty much his words.
Right.
But with the massive mail that came in, it wouldn't have been possible.
Mm-hmm. He's got so much mail.
What happened during the Watergate period when he got so much publicity, if he got letters from out of state,
the mail
that's where
up.
We got Will.
Oh, that's why we brought the Secretary of the Navy in.
Will first got a job.
Secretary of the Navy handled that.
It was stacked
did
up.
His office answer all the out of state Watergate
yes.
mail?
Yeah, he
first priority was
out of state as well.
First priority was in state mail.
It was almost a form letter. It wasn't a form letter, but it was one paragraph, and it was a. Auto pen signature. I mean, it was just
Don't give away the family secrets,
Dan.
Will convinced me that he wrote all those letters.
I'm sorry. Dan,
that's his job.
Senator read every one of them, Dan. As you know, he read every letter.
No.
Did y'all have what? If somebody wrote an unusually nasty letter, did you have a nut file that you just put it in unresponded?
We didn't call it
absolutely.
That.
Absolutely answered.
Choo choo. What was that?
Sam Nunn went to Senator Talmadge when Nunn was only a couple of years in at the Senate, and Sam Nunn tells this story. He says, I went to Herman and I was getting all these crazy letters, and he said, Senator Talmadge said, Sam.
So what do you do with the nut mail?
What do you do with the nut mail? And he says, Sam, if you lose, you answer them. If you lose the nut vote in Georgia, you don't get reelected.
Right.
That's pretty good. Yeah, I hadn't heard that.
That's what he lectured to me, yep. When I
got that
fell
lecture.
Behind on my
you
mail
answered the mail, and you had a timeline. He didn't like mail being delayed or late. Being
I think
answered.
It's a shame Bill Talmadge isn't here to tell some of his stories, because he could tell them better than anybody.
Okay, final anecdotes. I mean, we're just going to go around the table, and anything, if it's got some humor in it, it'd be great, but not long, but just a brief anecdote that you can recall that hasn't been said so far.
Well, don't start with me, because I'm at a loss to think of it.
Who's got one they want to start with? I want everybody to have the opportunity, but we'll start with whoever.
Well,
Rogers?
We all talked about Loquacious Hubert and the friendships between Dole and McGovern. The Senate, in its inimitable wisdom, had decided that they needed to do away with a committee that had been put together primarily because McGovern and Humphrey and Dole were all planning to run for president. And they all got along fine with each other. That wasn't the point. They had a committee that had no jurisdiction, that had no legislative ability, and about 150 staffers.
Yeah, a huge staff.
And it was going to be merged into the Agriculture Committee, mm-hmm. and in this reorganization. So one morning, Senator Talmadge had, and it was early, which was against the other three senators' normal procedures of the day. And they came in, and Senator Humphrey was going to be the spokesperson. He sat in the chair on the other side of the desk there on the right next to the spittoon. And Senator McGovern sat in the chair, and Dole wisely went further back down and where the couch was. And I was sitting over on a little side thing. And so Senator Humphrey, and I can't imitate him, but he at rapid Humphrey style. Just sound like a little machine gun going off. But he went through all of the real good reasons. Says, we've worked on this. We've worked on everything about this. We've worked out a detail. We know we've got to cut back on staff. And we've got it figured out just fine how we can do it amongst ourselves. I've forgotten the numbers that he said, but I'll get 30 here, and McGovern will have 30 here, and Bob's got 30 over here. Well, Dole was sitting down there at this time, not doing eye contact. He was going down like this and kind of watching down, and I could see that he had an evil grin on his face. So I could see him, but I don't think Senator Talmadge could. Well, then there was this moment of pregnant silence, and Senator Humphrey said, well, what do you think, Herman? He said, well, and he had a cigar. And he didn't spit in the platoon, but the threat was there the whole time, because you could tell Humphrey was sitting back from the line. And he says, I too have been thinking about it, and I've come to the conclusion that we need to do a little more paring down. And I've reached the conclusion that we can do it very equitably. We're going to cut down, and this was, I guess, whatever the number was that he had, but it was astronomically large and double digit. He turns and says, we cut it from 150 to 3. And Humphrey says, what? What do you mean, 3? A piece? Says, no, one for you, and one for you. He says, that seems like a fair arrangement. He says, well, that's a terrible, terrible defeat, Herman. We can't walk out of here like that. He says, oh, no, it's a magnificent victory. He says, no, we came in here with 150 people and you're coming out with 3? He says, no, you came in here with 0. You're leaving with 3.
That's great. What else? Who else has an
I'll give you a quick one. After he lost, somebody went up to him and asked him, what was the difference now being in the Senate and now being out? He says, well, now, he says, when some boob runs up to me and says, Herman, I bet you don't remember me. I just say, hell no, and I don't give a damn.
I like to watch him. I like to be in the office when he was talking on the telephone or had people there to watch his kind of demeanor. And when his mother, Miss Mitt, who lived to be, 100, yeah, would call, all of a sudden he was a typical son. You could hear, you could imagine what she was saying on the other line. Are you getting enough to eat? Yes, ma'am, I'm getting. He was answering all of his mother's questions on the phone, just like any of us would. And here he was, the United States Senator, and she was 100 years old. And then when because he was on the Finance Committee, all these foreign ambassadors and trade delegations would come in because the Finance Committee dealt with trade issues. Japanese in particular at that time were very active in Washington. And I think he thought if he talked louder, they could understand him. If they didn't speak English, so he was like, how you doing? And just scream at him because he thought they could understand the louder he talked. And then if he had a disdain for some bureaucrats that were in there, that were coming to convince him about something, he would use that spittoon very strategically, tactically. He would, well, I don't know, then he would lean up and kind of fire a big spit into the spittoon, and their feet would come up off the sofa because they were afraid it was going to splash up on them. And he knew, and they were just, if he thought they were being kind of a little bit condescending toward him as a Southern senator, then he would just put it on really, really thick and spit in the spittoon.
He probably did that particularly with lawyers, didn't he?
Well, it was bureaucrats.
And bankers.
Philip Heinemann, who was nominated as Assistant Secretary of HEW, later worked for GE, Ivy League all over,
Ben Heinemann's
a genius, comes in to see this redneck senator, and Talmadge did exactly what he turned it on and put his, and Heinemann couldn't get confirmed without Talmadge's blessing. And so it was a beautiful thing to watch. And before, and some of the stuff Talmadge said to him, I'm not going to repeat, but he put his arm around him, and you could see Heinemann's skin crawling that Talmadge even touched him. And Talmadge never put his arm around anybody, but he figured it out.
All right, who else got one? Will?
Well, Russell's, a lot of these great stories are not a colorful story. He was an earthy man, and he used earthy conversation sometimes to his advantage. But you know, I just want to last comment say the Senate is not what it was back then, and he was probably the last senator to engage in some of the old Southern courtesies and practices. He was the last senator, if you were a constituent, to come to his office. He came out to the reception room to greet you. You were not ushered in to see Senator Talmadge. If you wanted to see him and you were from Georgia, you saw him. You might have to be there at 7 o'clock in the morning, but he would see you. And if you called him from Georgia, he would talk
to
you,
call.
Perhaps only for 10 seconds. Before he asked Randy Nuckolls to pick up line three. But that's a those are practices of senators who were in touch with their constituents like they are not today. It's just,
it's a good
this
point.
Is before email. This is before cell phones. The most sophisticated technology in the office was a Watts line, which he would berate all of his colleagues from the Georgia delegation. If you use your Watts line and call your constituents on a regular basis, you'll be reelected.
You know, one of the amazing things that I saw about Talmadge, and it came to my attention one time, Senator Russell, who almost never did this, said, Charlie Weltner is having this party for these artists over in a House office building conference room. He said, we ought to go over there and support Charlie and show the flag. You want to walk over with me? So I walked over there with him, and we got in the door, and we got about 10 minutes after we got there, Senator Talmadge came in. And Senator Russell is still standing at the door talking to the same person he started talking to when he walked in. Senator Talmadge has gone through the whole crowd and left.
He had that gift.
My wife always says he always knew her name. It was either honey or sugar. Hey, honey, hey, sugar. He'd go around the room and say hello to everybody. Hey, honey, hey, sugar.
All right, Dan. I'm sorry. Mike, have you come up with yours?
He just tricked my memory on the Watts line. Talmadge was good at that. You know, he woke up about 3:30, and he got into the office when they opened the garage down that Senate court. And so he would get on the phone and call his friends back in Georgia. Hey, old so-and-so, how you doing this morning? You still laid up in the bed? You going to get bed sore.
Right.
Can I tell one more?
How's your soil moisture?
Yeah, let's Dan. Dan's a...
go ahead if you got one.
Dan, please. Yield well, you,
it,
Roger.
This reminded me of it, but Senator would come in. You know, he parked in the courtyard, and I parked over underground across the street. But you come in, and you didn't hear anybody. There wasn't anybody else in the Senate that time of day. Sane people were still home in bed. and you could hear that on that marble floor.
Right.
And if I got down to just to the corner down there, I could hear him rounding the corner. And the phone was ringing. Well, it would, and it was ring, 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 ring. And it was kind of something that you knew that nobody sane would call a Senate office at 6 o'clock in the morning, but they would call us because. So I start down through there, and he comes at the other end of the hall, and he's running every briefcase flapping. And he gets to the door first by about 30 yards and jumps in there and reaches over on the receptionist desk, answers the phone. And just as I got to the door, he says, "No, Mama, been here a while, been up a long time." Standing there with his ring, overcoat and his briefcase in his hand.
Dan?
I don't have anything humorous, though all of us could think of dozens of funny things that involved Herman Talmadge. I just think about how lucky I've been. As of September, I will have been here in Washington, 45 years. And I have,
Phi Alpha brother.
I worked for Herman Talmadge. I worked in the White House, and I've seen probably 250 or 300 senators come and go, and several hundred, a couple of thousand members of the House of Representatives. And Herman Talmadge was the brightest man I ever encountered in public life. I didn't say the most intellectual, though he was very well read.
Oh yeah, he was well read.
But he had such an analytical mind, and he was so concise. I thought that I could write before I went to work for Herman Talmadge, and I learned to write from Herman Talmadge, and I learned to talk from Herman Talmadge. And I can't tell you how grateful I am for what I learned from him.
Well, I want to thank.
Everybody at this
we
table.
All agree.
I want to thank Mike McLeod and Dan Tate and Rogers Wade and Russell King and Randy Nuckolls and Will Ball for this excellent discussion. And hopefully, in the future, when people see this, they will at least have some inkling of who Herman Talmadge was. And that's the purpose that we've been here today. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Charles.
Good job, Charles.
Very good.